Good evening, one and all. First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Raghav Panta from Abbott along with Mr. Amlan Bhatta and Madhu for giving me this opportunity to present to you liver disease, alcohol and non-alcohol. So my outline of the talk will be like a little bit on the large scale of alcohol liver disease. So what will be the natural history of alcohol liver disease? Couple of slides on alcoholic hepatitis and few slides on non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. And how are you going to differentiate between non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and alcoholic liver disease? This is very important in clinical practice because majority of the liver patients, so or persons who are drinking alcohol, will come to us for evaluation of liver disease. So that's how the topic has been chosen. So in the recent BMJ 2018, so this is what is the topic that has been there. So there is a changing landscape of alcoholic liver disease. It's a pooled analysis. Unfortunately, in India, we don't have a nurses database, so where we can know how the population is progressing or any of the diseases are increasing in number or not. So whereas in US, you tend to have, or in UK, you tend to have this large databases. So from 1999 to 2016, when all the CDC and death certificate data were chosen, the annual deaths from cirrhosis has increased almost by 65%. And the largest disease has been, if you look at the alcohol use disorder or alcohol-related liver disease is the cause of largest in the 25 to 34 years age group. So you can see in the last, so it is either the alcohol use disorder or alcohol-related liver disease that is the main driven force. And unfortunately, it has been happening in the younger age group, that is 25 to 34 years, because majority of the cirrhotics, earlier we used to think that it is elderly. But nowadays, more and more younger patients, and they are coming. So what is happening? So like the rising cirrhosis, almost like 0.1 to 0.2%. And alcohol has actually significantly jumped in 0.07% in 2009 to 0.1% in 2015. So if you say total population, 0.1% is a significant number. And more women have started to drink. So the increased prevalence of alcoholic liver disease is almost like 50% increase as compared to 2019 to 2015. And almost like there is 300% increase in the age less than 45 years age groups. That means more and more younger people are drinking alcohol. And majority of the increase is because of more and more women have started drinking. This is a changing landscape that we might be seeing. So don't forget to take an alcohol history in an young woman with cirrhotic. So main difference between alcoholic and non-alcoholic is alcoholic liver disease patients are more sicker because they tend to have both sinusoidal as well as post-sinusoidal portal hypertension. They tend to get admitted more frequently because more and more younger generation, that is less than 45 years age group are happening, the more admissions, it has doubled the healthcare costs predominantly in the cirrhotic in the alcohol group. So these are all the couple of questions that were commonly asked in the DM questionnaire. So like, what are alcohol holidays? So holidays are the time to celebrate with friends, family and loved ones. So majority of the time, what happens is binging of alcohol will happen. So for a typical adult, so what does this mean? Alcohol holiday means you need to remember the number 5 and number 4 for women. 5 or more drinks in man, 4 or more drinks in women. And it has to be taken in less than 2 hours. So the time duration as well as the quantity, both are important to call it as an alcohol holiday, 5, 4 and within 2 hours time. So what are the questionnaire for alcohol use disorder? So these have to be used. CAGE questionnaire is commonly used. So, but you need to know that CAGE questionnaire is not what is happening now. So CAGE questionnaire is the previous 12 months, that is in 1 year time. Has a patient anytime felt like cutting down on alcohol, or any of the people have annoyed you by criticizing your drinking? So annoyed is a A. Have you ever felt guilt or bad about your drinking habit? Have you ever had a drink first thing in the morning as an eye opener? So this is called as a CAGE questionnaire, initially published in JAMA. If at all 2 or more are positive, so we say that the person is dependent or alcohol use disorder. We don't use the term alcoholic nowadays. We should be using the term AUD, that is alcohol use disorder. The other questionnaire that majority of the DM students will get is what is called as Audit C questionnaire. You need not remember all the values, but the 3 questions you should be able to remember. That is, how often do you have a drink which is containing alcohol? And how many standard drinks are there on a typical day? And how often do you drink six or more in one occasion? Six or more drinks in one occasion. These are the three questions you should be by hearting. In each question, you will have five columns. Each one will be marked 0 to 4. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the maximum marks that a person is going to get is 12. In men, a score of 4 or more. In women, a score of 3 or more are considered positive or patients are going for hazardous alcohol use disorder. This is National Alcohol Abuse Single Questionnaire, Single Screening Questionnaire. So rather than using the CAGE questionnaire or the Audit C questionnaire, you don't have time in the casualty or in your OPD. So you can just ask a single screening questionnaire, which is almost like 90% sensitivity, in telling like how many times in the past 1 year have you had more than 5 or in men and more than 4 in women drinks in a day. So in a day, it is important. So this is what are called as screening questionnaires to identify people who are having alcohol use disorder. So what does this drink mean? So this is 12 ounces of beer, 8 ounces of wine or 5 ounces of wine and 1.5 ounce, that is almost like 45 ml of whiskey, rum or gin, so which contains 40% alcohol. So these are all constitute what is called as a single drink. So this is the source is National Institute of Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism. This is NIAAA. So you can Google this, like majority of the patient information as well as doctor information is from this. So you need to remember the drink. You need to remember the questionnaire to ask. You need to remember what are the typical alcohol holidays or how many times a person is drinking. Then the next question, majority of the time, it will be the relatives who will be asking, like how much alcohol is hazardous for a particular patient. Is it going to be a dose response or is it going to be a threshold effect? So this is a large prospective cohort from Denmark, almost like 6,000 patients. All the patients were included, that is 15 to 83 years age group. So if you see, there is a higher fold increase of mortality in women, almost like 35 fold as compared to 27 fold, with an average daily drinks of 5 or more times per day. And it has been noted that it is more like a threshold effect rather than a dose response. Majority of the time they tell that I've been drinking very occasionally, or they might be comparing with their friends, like who might be drinking much more than what they are drinking. So, but we need to remember that it is a threshold or an individualized perception of the dose that is very crucial, rather than a cumulative dose, like how much is a cumulative dose. So what happens when a person drinks alcohol? So you can see the gross liver, how exactly the changes will be. On the top, there is a histology that you are seeing. In a normal liver, so you get the typical, if you do a liver biopsy, you get the typical sinusoids with the dilated central venule, and you tend to have the portal tracts at the corners. So 90% of the heavy drinkers so tend to develop more than 5% of the hepatocytes to have fat content, predominantly triglyceride. Then the liver will start appearing brighter on the ultrasound, what we term it as steatosis. Whether a person is drinking alcohol, we call it as alcoholic steatosis. If a person is not drinking that quantity of alcohol, so then we call it as a non-alcoholic steatosis, that is NAS, NASH. So that is predominantly noted in 90% of the drinkers. Out of this 20%, you need to remember the 20 in alcohol, 20% of the time will have a subsequent inflammation. Anything in the biopsy, it appears more violet. So these are all the plasma cells, lymphocytes and all. So whenever there is excess neutrophilic infiltration, so there is an inflammation that is happening, that becomes NASH, that is non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. Or if a person is drinking a significant alcohol content, it is alcoholic steatohepatitis. Any inflammation, the healing is by the process of stellate cell formation, and then the fibrosis and a defective regeneration will happen. So you tend to have a fibrosis, and there will be a little bit of regeneration that will be happening, and then they tend to develop either a regenerative nodule, or it can become a dysplastic nodule and then ultimately land up with hepatocellular carcinoma over time. So again, 20% of the time may progress to cirrhosis, out of which 10% may develop hepatocellular carcinoma. Reversing of this is happening with abstinence or a couple of treatment modalities that we are going to discuss. If at all a cirrhotic person decompensates in the form of jaundice or bleed or encephalopathy, so we call it as a decompensated liver disease. One more component in alcohol that you need to remember is what is called as an important component is alcoholic hepatitis. This is like AH, we call it as, whenever there is jaundice or decompensated liver function, predominantly in the form of coagulopathy, in the setting of significant alcoholic intake, some of the treatment modalities can actually reverse it. So that is an alcoholic hepatitis. So what are all the risk factors for this progression of alcoholic liver disease? One is female sex. Second one is drinking pattern as well as binging. What I have mentioned is alcohol holiday. How much is the quantity consumed? If at all there is a concomitant obesity or hepatitis C virus, the progression of liver disease will be much faster. So what we call it as obesity, earlier we used to call it as non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Nowadays, more and more the terminology has been changed to MAFLD, that is metabolic associated fatty liver disease, because even people who are like non-alcoholic fatty liver disease will be drinking occasionally alcohol. So how can you say that they are non-alcoholic? So nowadays it has been asked like, or it has been mentioned as MAFLD, that is metabolic associated fatty liver disease. And couple of genetics, predominantly a person drinks alcohol, two enzymes are crucial, alcohol dehydrogenase and aldehyde dehydrogenase. Genetic polymorphisms of these two enzymes can also increase the risk factor. So what are all the genetics? So whenever you say alcohol use disorder, the enzymes which are important is alcohol dehydrogenase and aldehyde dehydrogenase. So the genetic polymorphisms can change. If at all the first drink of a particular person is at the age of 14 years, always people will remember the first drink, first time they smoke. So whenever the first drink is 14 years, the cumulative action will be much more. Male gender is more common for alcohol use disorder. Family history of alcohol use disorder, low socioeconomic status, emotional trauma, and then social norms. Like predominantly, if you see Northeast, the welcome drink will be alcohol. So like social norms is another thing that you should be looking at, where the person is coming from. These are all for the alcohol use disorder risk. So majority of the time, these people, the relatives will be bringing just because a person is drinking too much of an alcohol. But if you say once the person has developed an alcoholic liver disease, the risk is whenever there is a concomitant PNPLA3, so that is predominantly adiponutrin, like a lot of data is coming up, especially in MAFLD or non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, because as Asians, we carry this PNPLA3 polymorphisms, where we tend to have more abdominal obesity, thereby we are predisposed for metabolic syndrome. What is the alcohol amount and the daily drinking? Women tend to have more body fat distribution as well as lesser of alcohol dehydrogenase. So they are more predisposed for development of liver disease. Concomitant smoking, HCV, iron, as well as coffee intake. So especially a person who is drinking excess coffee, there can be higher chance of liver disease in case there is a concomitant alcohol intake. So after a discussion on the alcoholic liver disease, the next important component that we'll be touching upon is alcoholic hepatitis. So whenever itis is there, it is inflammation. So alcoholic hepatitis is an acute inflammatory syndrome, which is characterized by jaundice and liver injury that occurs in the subset of patients after decades of heavy alcohol use. So what is the minimal criteria? So jaundice within prior 8 weeks. So ongoing consumption of more than 40 in female or 60 in men, alcohol grams per day for 6 months or more, bili more than 3 mg per deciliter, AST more than 50, AST by ALT more than 1.5. So ALT is SGPT, so AL has got L for liver. So ALT is specific for liver dysfunction. But ALT requires pyridoxal phosphate for synthesis. So generally in alcoholics, there will be deficiency of B6. Thereby, the ALT will be lesser in contrast to AST. So whenever we see in the LFT pattern, AST more than ALT, alcohol history is negated. You think about it is something happening systemically. It is not primarily liver. If at all alcohol history is there, then it is significant. And you say that it can be an alcoholic cirrhotic underlying. And definitely diagnosis is biopsy, but more often it is a clinical setting that we try to make a diagnosis of alcoholic hepatitis. Any liver enzyme elevation, so we need to always rule out the other etiologies. So predominantly you need to look for HBsAg and anti-HCV. We don't do DNA, RNA unless we are thinking of looking for a liver transplant. So we do a screening test of HBsAg and anti-HCV antibody to rule out underlying hepatitis B or C. Hepatitis B is endemic. We are in intermediate endemicity zone, so which is almost like 2-7%. And HCV is like 0.5-1.5%. So we should not be missing an underlying viral apart from the alcohol intake. So we should also look for ANA profile, predominantly ANA as a screening factor, also IF also we can do. But predominantly it is better to do an ANA profile, and this value should be less than 1:80. Your borderline positive may or may not pick up, so that doesn't carry the value. If at all it is more than 1:80, you need to think that there can be an underlying autoimmune liver disease as well. The person should not be septic. Majority of these patients, they can have minimal encephalopathy, little bit of coagulopathy with the INR more than 1.5. Because there is an inflammation within the liver, there will be a leukoerythrocytosis, that is the total count might be high. But typically they may not have fever, or they may not have a localizing symptoms. Predominantly we look at urine, chest, skin, perianal area, plus minus ascitic fluid. These are all the five areas that we always look for, and it should be absence of sepsis. There should be absence of a recent drug that can cause a drug-induced liver injury potential. Predominantly you need to look for three drugs. One is anti-epileptics, second one is anti-tubercular drugs, and the third one is antiretroviral. So majority of the time these three, plus minus Kohmatz Club. So majority of the time it should be less than 30 days. If at all it is more than 30 days, less likely that it is. Some of the delayed drugs can also cause, but less than 30 days it should be absent. And there should not be any documented hypotension. So like if at all there is a ischemia, that can also present like deranged liver enzymes. And definitely metabolic syndrome, so we are going to discuss in NAFLD. So how are you going to assess the severity in alcoholic hepatitis? Again, couple of scores you need to remember. So the most commonly used is MADRI score, so where you tend to have bili plus INR. So you can write the formula, but majority of the time we look for what are the components. And we say severe alcoholic hepatitis whenever it is more than 32. And that is going to give you a value that we can initiate steroids. MELD is model for end-stage liver disease. So this we should keep on doing it in day-to-day practice, where the components that you need to have in the patient labs are bilirubin, PTINR, creatinine. So these three values, if you are there, so you can always go into online computer and then you can put these values. You tend to get a MELD. If at all MELD is more than or equal to 21, so the most important thing is it is going to prognosticate a patient. And how are you going to make the person in the transplant listing? So a person who has got a higher MELD in the DDLT scenario, they will get the priority as compared to a person who is going to have a lower MELD. So the same MELD you are going to use as a continuous marker whether the person is improving or not improving. Otherwise, the question that you face is like, I'm taking regular medicine, I'm under your regular follow-up. So how am I improving? So you are going to use this course as a prognostic model, whether the person is improving or not improving, or should we list them for transplant, if at all the person is agreeing for that. Glasgow alcohol hepatitis score, it is bili plus INR plus creat plus age plus total count. This is going to have a poor prognosis if at all it is more than 9, so or equal to 9. This is for initiation of steroids. You should be able to tell MADRI's discriminant function. You should be able to tell MELD, you should be able to tell Glasgow alcoholic hepatitis score. These three are for both prognosis as well as initiation of steroid. Once you give a steroid, the score that we are going to use is a Lilly score, so which has got bilirubin, INR, creat, age, and instead of a total count in GAHS, it is albumin here. This is a Lilly score model that you do on day 1 of starting steroid and day 7 of starting steroid. So annotate. Okay. So if at all it is more than or equal to 0.45, so it is not response. Less than 0.45 is response. So the problem in Lilly score is whenever there is a decision making, there can be a little bit of a partial response. So what are we going to do? At that time, there can be a chance of problem in the decision making. Yeah. So something annotate came. So yeah. So what is the treatment you give for alcoholic hepatitis? So predominantly this is the steroids in alcoholic hepatitis. The first study is by Mathurin, basically Journal of Hepatology 2002. So it's a pooled analysis of all the patients where discriminant function, that is MADRS, was checked, which is more than 32. And predominantly they looked at 1 month and 6 month mortality, as well as what is the impact on encephalopathy and how does the Lilly score fare. So the good thing is there should be like a 30% risk reduction. So if you see the survival with or without steroids, there is a 80% survival benefit at 1 month, and at 6 months is almost like 66%. So that means they are surviving at the end of 6 months is almost 66%, which was statistically significant. So that means if you have a subset of people who are having significant enzyme elevation, significant bilirubin elevation, which is more than 3 mg/dL in the setting of alcohol, don't brand them as alcoholic liver disease alone. So do a MADRI, do a MELD, identify alcoholic hepatitis patients, and then you can initiate steroids. So this is one trial that we used to tell quite often. This was published in NEJM. So like this is what is called a STOPA trial. That is steroids or pentoxifilin for alcoholic hepatitis. So when I used to do DM, so we used to use pentoxifilin quite a bit. Nowadays it has been stopped after this STOPA trial. So this is 2x2 factorial double blind randomized trial. So you see the number of patients is almost like more than 1,000 patients after screening of more than 5,000, predominantly an UK based study. And they have identified that pentoxifilin at dose of 400 mg 3 times in a day. So there is no improvement in the outcome of these patients. Steroids, how are you going to give? We tend to give prednisolone at 40 mg once in a day dose for 1 month. And then we try to taper it in the next 2 to 4 weeks. That is the idea of giving steroids in these patients, because it is predominantly the inflammatory cascade that is happening within the liver. So it has got a beneficial effect on short term, but no improvement in the long term. And 30% of the people do not respond to steroids. So how are you going to identify these 30% is by the use of Lilly score. The limitation of this study is there were people with active bacterial and viral infections, predominantly like either having spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, so which is predominantly monobacterial, culture positive, and pleocytic, that is neutrophil count more than 250, in the background of high sag low protein ascites, or pneumonia, or an urinary tract infection, or people with fever and leukocytosis. In those people, we need to look at the PAN cultures, chest X-ray, antibiotic prophylaxis based on Procal and CRP. So Lilly score is the most important thing that we need to monitor in a person who is on steroids in alcoholic hepatitis. So STOPA trial has stopped using pentoxifilin in alcoholic hepatitis. Steroids definitely yes, especially when there is a higher MADRI and higher MELD. So we are going to tell the patients that 30% may not respond. We can identify people who are going to respond, and those people tend to have a better outcome at short-term level. So that is definitely the short-term mortality is going to be reduced. The problems in STOPA trial is there is no liver biopsy. So the trial patients are much lesser sicker. The 20-day mortality was much lower than expected. So usually we tend to have because alcoholic hepatitis people are more sicker. So they tend to have a higher mortality as well as higher renal dysfunction as compared to the people who have been included in the STOPA trial. So there appears to be some selection bias. And like the long-term follow-up, like there is no much change, because people who tend to have milder disease, then generally they tend to fare well. So those were the key problems in STOPA, but it is an important trial that you need to quote. It got published in NEJM, so which is a large database study. The most important key is the abstinence. So unless or until the patient is motivated, it becomes difficult for the doctor to pitch in. If a person is motivated, not able to quit, a consultation liaison with a psychiatrist will definitely help the patient and the family in stopping alcohol. But if at all the person is not motivated, so it becomes difficult, because they might be kept in rehab for some time. Once they are come back to their kingdom, they will restart the alcohol. So abstinence is a key. So this is a couple of studies in hepatology 2017. So where they looked at a prospective and a retrospective studies, almost like 100 to 300 patients. Whenever a person is completely abstinent, they tend to have a better long-term survival. So like... age more than 45 years and lack of prior alcohol treatments were associated with long-term abstinence. And definitely a psychiatric consultation is very crucial. Are there any other therapies that are going to be helpful in alcoholic liver disease apart from prednisolone? So these are all again a couple of journals, one in NEJM 2011 and American Journal of Gastroenterology in 2014. So where they looked at pred plus N-acetylcysteine versus prednisolone alone. So almost like 174 patients were included in the study. The advantage of N-acetylcysteine is it has got antioxidant properties. It is going to increase glutathione, thereby the oxidant potential is going to reduce. And the advantage is it doesn't have immunosuppressive side effects in contrast to the steroids. So definitely adding N-acetylcysteine improves survival at 1 month, but it is not seen in the long term. That is by 3 to 6 months, it is not seen. So if at all a person has got significant coagulopathy, I think we should be prescribing more and more N-acetylcysteine. If at all coagulopathy is not much, so then again, the survival or it is going to add on to the cost of the treatment. This is a study by Singh et al. From Indian studies, so where they looked at G-CSF plus pentoxifilin versus pentoxifilin alone. 46 patients were included. So the advantage of granulocyte colony stimulating factor is basically it mobilizes stem cells and at 3 months, it improved MELD as well as survival. But again, there might be a selection bias in these patients because couple of people, the study had a higher than expected mortality. So therapies predominantly you need to look for, especially when there is a MADRS which is more than 32, MELD more than 20 or 21. So you need to do an ultrasound abdomen to exclude other causes of jaundice, predominantly like Bacchiari syndrome, where there can be chance of hepatic venous outflow tract obstruction or a portal vein thrombosis. Or majority of the alcohol can have concomitant liver abscess. So we should not be missing a treatable condition rather than branding every patient of alcohol having an alcoholic liver disease. Always screen for infection, either in the lung, that is by doing a chest X-ray, urine by doing at least a urine routine microscopy for pyuria, crystalluria or leukocyte esterase. Blood, look at the counts, look at the CRP, procal. If at all they look little suspicious, you can always do a baseline liver blood culture. Acetic fluid, look at if at all there is it is there. So the most important thing is you need to do a diagnostic tag. Keep or load the acetic fluid in the culture bottle. If at all it comes pleocytic, then you can send for culture analysis. The contraindications for steroid approaches, like these are all very important as far as the MCQs are considered. So like contraindications for steroids in alcoholic hepatitis is whenever there is an uncontrolled infection or sepsis, whenever there is a concomitant acute kidney injury with a creatinine more than 2.5, so uncontrolled upper GI bleeding, concomitant diseases like bloodborne virus screen, which has got HIV, HBsAg and HCV, drug-induced liver injury, HCC, pancreatitis and tuberculosis, concomitant shock or multi-organ dysfunction. So out of all this, you should be remembering pancreatitis, GI bleed, AKI and uncontrolled infections. Even if you write these four as contraindications for steroid in alcoholic hepatitis, it should be good. There is another problem in alcoholic hepatitis, even though it is severe. So people follow this what is called a 6-month abstinence rule. So even in Ramaya, the first transplant we did, like the person by day 7, so he wanted an alcohol. So he was like abusing sisters and all. So because of all the addiction potential, so alcohol has got a significant craving. That's why majority, almost like 85 centers in USA and Europe, so they always have this what is called a 6-month rule or a 6-month abstinence prior to listing a patient for transplant. Because if you list for transplant, they may outrun people who are already waiting in the transplant list. So like because their MELD will be higher, they are more sicker. So they get the organ much more frequently. And if at all they go back to alcohol, so that means the new liver also will become an alcoholic liver disease. So and majority of the alcoholic hepatitis, so the 3-month mortality is very high. So like this is still a debatable issue, like should we persist on the 6 month or can we transplant early so that the life of a particular person can be prolonged. But usually they wait on 6 months, look for the the inherent liver to regenerate, and then if at all it regenerates, a decompensated liver can become compensated, and then the person can have little better life. Very important thing, which is nutrition and health, like because majority of these people will be alcohol and they will be taking what is called as empty calories, because majority of the time they tend to eat spicy food and they will be already full by the time they come home and they will not take the normal nourishment. So they will be deficient both on the macronutrients and micronutrients. Macronutrients are predominantly three: carbohydrate, protein and fat. Micronutrients typically are less than 100 micrograms per day, which predominantly include vitamins and minerals. There is no harm in giving the routine B-complex medicines for these people because they will be definitely deficient and we cannot check each and every micronutrient. So what are we going to do? So we are going to look at predominantly amino acids, predominantly especially the methionine. So we tend to see more often we give acetinosin methionine as a supplement. That is because it is predominantly a sulfur containing essential amino acid. And it is going to enhance the glutathione, which is going to have the redox potential reduction. Thereby, it helps in improving the liver. So it has come mainly as a nutraceutical, but it has got impact on improving the liver function. So that is a component. So there are multiple other standard amino acids where leucine, isoleucine, like which are predominantly a branched chain amino acids, like where we tend to give, like to bypass the urea cycle because liver is in a failure situation. So the urea cycle will be a problem, thereby excess ammonia will be there, and that is the primary agent. There are multiple other neurotransmitters which will be problematic, but ammonia hypothesis is urea cycle is defective, thereby the ammonia is going to increase in the body and that is going to cause the encephalopathy. So whenever we give branched chain amino acids, that ammonia cycle will be a little bypassed, thereby the lowering of the ammonia will happen and the person's improvement will be better. So this we tend to use in people who are having overt hepatic encephalopathy as infusion, or a person who is coming back to encephalopathy again and again, we tend to give an oral supplement. So what is the algorithm? So once you make a clinical diagnosis of alcoholic hepatitis with a background of history of significant alcohol and you are having a bilirubin, if at all there is a 2 or 3, like there is a metabolic plus drug, so we tend to, if the INR is fine, we tend to do a biopsy. We exclude other infections. So like then you need to look at the nutritional nutrition of the person. So you need to target the daily calorie intake to 35 to 40 kilocalories per kg body weight. Preferably we tend to give orally because parenteral nutrition again may cause canaliculate dysfunction in the liver and thereby the bilirubin excretion will be a problem. You can safely supplement with B-complex vitamins. Then you need to look at the scoring, that is MADRS more than 32 or GAHS, that is Glasgow Alcoholic Hepatitis score more than 9. So then you tend to give prednisolone plus minus NAC. NAC especially we need to remember that, especially when the INR is more than 1.5. So after you give for a week's time, you assess the Lilly score. So like where Lilly score reduces less than 0.45, you can continue for like already 1 week is over. So continue for a month's time. And after that 2 to 4 weeks time, you can reduce the steroids. If at all it is more than or equal to 0.45, you stop the treatment and then you consider for an early transplant. If at all discriminant fraction is less than 32 or GHS less than 9, so it is all supportive therapy either by giving UDCA or acetinosin methionine or a combination. So we heard about alcoholic liver disease and that various regimens or treatments that you tend to use both for alcoholic liver disease as well as for the alcoholic hepatitis. Now we come to the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. If you see the percentages is all the same. So you're like a normal liver. If a person becomes metabolic like obese, like you tend to have 20% of the adults may have fatty liver. Out of this, like steatohepatitis will happen, out of which 20% may progress to cirrhosis and another 20% may develop HCC. That is malignancy. So there will be an important question that will be asked in the exam, like what is the difference between an adult NASH and a pediatric NASH? So in adult NASH, the important problem that is happening is in the centrilobular area. So like if you see the portal tract, you have portal tracts at the periphery, whereas the venule is in the center, so the which is going to go to the hepatic veins. So the sinusoids will be in between. So in an adult NASH, it is happening at the center. So where there is a centrilobular steatosis, ballooning, malrehaline, as well as sinusoidal fibrosis will happen. Whereas in pediatric NASH, it is all diffuse. The entire hepatocyte is full of fat. And majority of the inflammation is happening at the portal tract area. So this is a major difference that you should remember. P for P, in pediatric, there is a periportal inflammation as well as fibrosis. So you need to remember this important difference, because pediatric NASH can progress to cirrhosis very quickly. And NASH is a multi-system disease. Like obesity causes metabolic stress, systemic inflammation. So we need to look for cardiac, coronary, hypertension, peripheral vascular disease. Predominantly, we need to aim at weight loss and give the respective drugs depending upon which organ, whether it is heart, kidney or liver or pancreas, which is getting involved. Nowadays, more and more pancreatic steatosis is also coming up in a big way. So where these people can progress to chronic pancreatitis. What are all the risk factors for secondary pancreatic, hepatic steatosis? So either it is microvesicular, so that is the nucleus in the hepatocyte is in the central with multiple fat globules surrounding, or it is a macrovesicular, that is in the hepatocyte, there is a large fat globule which is pushing the nucleus to the periphery. So microvesicular, the characteristic examples are Reye syndrome or acute fatty liver of pregnancy or health, drugs like antiretroviral or valproate, and inborn errors of metabolism. These are all the things that cause microvascular steatosis. Macrovascular are alcohol, HCV, Wilson's, methotrexate and steroids, A-beta lipoproteinemia, starvation and TPN. So at least if you tell the first four in both the columns, that should be all right. So macrovascular, you remember alcohol, HCV, Wilson's, drugs, predominantly methotrexate and steroids. So alcohol is one thing which can cause macrovascular and micronodular cirrhosis. The nodules that are going to develop are less than 3 mm. This is one more thing, table that you should be able to tell even in your sleep. So this is ATP3 scenario, which is metabolic syndrome. So where you need to define, you know, so like the values are important. So if you're not able to tell the values, you have not biheaded the table correctly. Fasting sugar should be more than or equal to 110. A lot of times you think that 100 is the cutoff. No. So fasting sugar more than or equal to 110 milligram per deciliter. Blood pressure is more than or equal to 130 by 85 millimeters of mercury. Don't ask me how 85 will be looked at. Majority of the time it will be an even value. But this is what is the ATP3 definition, and you need to stick to the definition. It is more than or equal to 130 by 85. HDL, men less than 40, women less than 50. Triglyceride is more than or equal to 150 milligram per deciliter. Men more than 102 centimeter at the waist. Women more than 88 centimeter at the waist circumference. They are at a higher risk of metabolic syndrome. In this, you need to remember that HDL and central obesity doesn't have more than or equal to or less than or equal to. The remaining triglyceride, fasting sugar, blood pressure have got this more than or equal to. So you need to remember that values, very important. So what are all the risk factors for NAFLD? So the major comorbidities, we always look for diabetes, dyslipidemia, obesity and concomitant metabolic syndrome. So we are going to look for what has contributed a particular person to develop NAFLD or MAFLD. So the emerging associations are hypothyroid, sleep apnea, hypopituitarism, hypogonadism, PCOD and pancreatic surgeries. So these are all the emerging associations. So you may not be surprised if a hypothyroid person is obese, like, because that is definitely an emerging association. And if you do a scan, definitely there will be a fatty liver. Similarly, they tend to have a shorter neck, they tend to snore at night, and an obstructive sleep apnea is going to happen. So as medical professional, we can look at only the treatment perspective, whether the TSH is under correct or not. So what is the main difference in NAFLD versus ALD? So these are all the biochemistry difference. I'm not going into the details of the metabolic syndrome, but if you look at the hemoglobin, that is MCV, macrocytosis is very common in alcoholic liver disease. So the liver, the RBCs are much more bigger. AST and ALT, I have told earlier. So if at all a person has progressed to cirrhosis, at that time the AST will be more. But if at all ALT, scenario like significant alcohol intake is there, at that time again AST will be more. So that is very characteristic of alcoholic liver disease. If a person is drinking alcohol, alcohol is again a mitochondrial toxicity, so you tend to get a GGT elevation. So in your LFT, if at all AST is more than ALT, think that it can be alcohol. GGT is more, think that it is alcohol. And MCV is more think that it is alcohol. History of alcohol intake, all this can be arbitrary. Then look at the patient. If at all a person is metabolic syndrome is there. In your lipid profile, triglyceride can be falsely very high in an alcoholic liver disease. Don't get that only triglyceride elevation is fitting into NAFLD. Always have your entire panel of ATP3 before you make a diagnosis of metabolic syndrome. But still, it can be a component of metabolic plus alcohol, so that we may have to see. This is for the DM people, like where they look at the scoring system, like the age, AST, LT, platelet count, BMI, albumin, and impaired fasting glucose, where it either it can be used as a NAS score or NAFLD score or FIB4 score. So different cutoffs are there. You just need to remember less than and more than. Don't remember the middle value. So then it will be like the middle value, if you remember, it becomes easier for you to write on the top or the bottom. But you need to look at the cutoff values. That is very important. So one slide on FibroScan, because we used to do FibroScan quite a bit, again, support from about, like basically like this is transient elastography. So where it comes as kilopascal, like how much exactly is the shear wave of the liver. So it is a non-invasive, less than 6 kPa, it is predominantly a normal and there is no liver disease. If at all it is more than 12.5, there is higher chance that this person tend to have more F3 or F4 fibrosis. So whatever is in the middle, so we need to look for, by doing an ultrasound, look for congestion of the vessels like hepatic veins or person is cholestatic or person has taken a recent diuretic dose or a person underwent ERCP where excess contrast has been injected into the liver. So there can be a chance that it can be falsely high, so the FibroScan values. But the advantage is it can be, as liver biopsy, we cannot keep doing repeatedly. FibroScan can be used repeatedly such that we can know how the person is improving. The next important treatment for NAFLD is a weight loss. So we are going to focus at more than 10% of the body weight reduction. So like fibrosis regression. But it doesn't mean that a person loses weight, the fibrosis is going to regress completely. No, only 45% of the patients are going to regress on the fibrosis. So these are all the analysis of a 4 randomized trial, but we are going to tell them that weight loss is a bottom line in treatment of either the obesity or the metabolic syndrome or for the fatty liver treatment, and fibrosis improvement or happens in 45% of the time if a person loses 10% of the body weight. Diet is crucial, so they need to limit the total caloric intake, especially the carbohydrate. So we always tell whatever white you tend to avoid. So that is white rice, white potatoes, flour, tortillas, pizzas, pastas, chips, fructose containing sodas and juices, because a lot of times people tend to have a craving for Coca-Cola or Pepsi. That is what like open happiness scenario. Like because these are all excess concentrated sugar solutions, and definitely all of us tend to have a sweet tooth. So definitely we tend to take this inside. So then there is higher chance that we may develop fatty liver. So it's always better that we limit on the processed carbohydrate, especially what are all the white scenario. Important thing is physical inactivity is very much linked to the fatty liver disease. So we are going to advise people to become more active physically. So because they tend to have central adiposity. So only way that is going to come down is by aggressive weight reduction by physical exertion. So people tend to ask like what exercise should we be doing to reduce the body weight. So there is no single exercise. So whenever they tend to eat a hypocaloric diet, and the intensity of the exercise should be moderate. Otherwise they talk to the doctor and immediately for 10 days they do an aggressive exercise. They document the 2 kgs of weight reduction and after that they stop on it. So it should be like a sustained weight loss. That is the bottom line in the treatment of NAFLD. Last couple of slides. So this is on ursodeoxycholic acid. So what are all the mechanism of ursodeoxycholic acid? Like it is a cholerectic effect. So it stimulates the excretion of the bilirubin from the hepatocytes as well as cholangiocytes. Like because the main problem is whenever there is excess hydrophobic acids, it causes an oxidative stress. And this ursodeoxycholic acid is a tertiary bile acid, that is a normal bile acid which is there in the body. So it is so safe that even in pregnancy and lactating women we can give. So whenever there is a excess ursodeoxycholic acid, the injured bile duct cells, that is predominantly at the canalicular level, the apoptosis is going to come down. So thereby it causes a cytoproduction of the hepatocytes. As long as the hepatocytes, they are the stem cells which can regenerate to the full potential. That's why we tend to commonly use UDCA for all the people who are jaundiced. So because of these effects, it also has got anti-inflammatory effect. Partial effects are agonist effect, antioxidant effect, inhibition of apoptosis of hepatocytes. So these are all work at the hepatocyte level as well as canalicular level. So we tend to use ursodeoxycholic acid to 15 to 25 milligram per kg body weight. We need to remember the side effect of ursodeoxycholic acid is diarrhea, because whenever you use excess of bile acid, they tend to have loose stools. If at all a person is having loose stools, look at the lactulose, look at the UDCA, try to reduce on the UDCA if at all we are getting significant as compared to the body weight. So the main component of injury on ethanol is hepatic mitochondria. So they tend to have mega mitochondria. So their size is going to become increased, similar to the macrocytes in the RBC. So which is going to have effect on the mitochondrial function. So once the injury is going to be coming down by giving UDCA, so I think the patients will automatically start improving, and then they keep under regular follow-up. Even though the LFT is bang normal, once we have documented that if a person has developed an alcoholic-induced liver injury or a liver disease, keep them on follow-up once in 3 to 6 months' time. Once in 6 months, do a scan, because these are all pre-malignant conditions. We should not be missing an early HCC. I think that is my last slide. So thank you. So this is a little additional tomorrow. Like this is what is called as a this month in endoscopy time. So this will be predominantly for gastroenterology PGs. So a journal predominantly for the consultants. So any questions to the extent possible, I am free to take. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for this excellent presentation. Yeah, doctors, now we. Sir is open for questions. Any questions, please, you can unmute yourself and ask, or you can use the chat box next to the mute button as well. Due to privacy laws, we cannot unmute from our end. You have to unmute yourself and ask. Sir, while the audience are asking, may I ask a few questions, sir?
Please,
sir, in the beginning, you explained about the, you know, different quantities of alcohol as well, sir. But is there anything like quality of alcohol as well, sir, like this alcohol is and that alcohol, because that I think we don't assess, sir, and how do you, you know, see the patient? Because I think mostly the poors are affected because of the low quality of alcohol.
No, it is not only the low quality of alcohol, the backdrop is the poor nutrition as well. So it is not only the quality of alcohol. So like, but the problem is the content and the quality, we don't have a control. You know, so the studies doesn't give you that demarcation whether black label or red label is okay, or should it be the tardy scenario, that is local made liquor is okay. So majority of the time there will be a mixture of whenever they do a local alcohol scenario, there will be a mixture of alcohols. It is not a pure alcohol. So that's why yes. You don't have the drink definition in that. So that is a concern in whenever we mention a local made liquor. So we don't have that in the definition scenario. And majority of these are coming from the West. So NA definition or ASLD definition. So that's why we don't have that local preparation. So we take like whether the person is drinking or not drinking. What is the quantity? When is the last binge? And how many times a person is binging? And what is the presentation that a person is going through? Jaundice, ascites, bleed, encephalopathy. And then we look at the labs, look at the MELD, look at the discriminant function. Based on that, we assess whether a person is severe or whether the person is in the mild spectrum. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. We got a question from Rajesh, sir. Sir is asking maximum dose of, I think, lactulose and other modes of preventing hepatic encephalopathy.
So thank you, sir, for asking that. So like basically lactulose is a synthetic disaccharide, which is a combination of galactose plus fructose. So because it is a disaccharide, so whenever we take disaccharide, so it works as an osmotic laxative. So it draws in water into the lumen, and thereby the stools will become softer and the person will pass stool. There is no maximum cutoff dose. It is basically a maximum tolerable dose, we call it as. So we titrate the lactulose in the form of the person should purge at least 3 times stool per day. So the target is basically the person should have 3 to 4 times stools per day. Then the chance of it, a person going into encephalopathy will be less likely. So like, how does the lactulose work? So it is going to make the stool acidic. The ammonia, NH3, becomes ammonium, NH4+. NH4 doesn't get absorbed. So like, it is going to get excreted. So in the ammonia lowering hypothesis, we tend to give lactulose. The maximum tolerable dose is going to be determined by the patient. Like a lot of times the side effect we need to tell to the patient that they may have more gaseousness because we are giving a carbohydrate orally. Any carbohydrate will be acted upon by bacteria and a lot of hydrogen and methane a person will be releasing. It will be a non-foul smelling gas that will be going to come. Whenever there is excess gas within the abdomen, people tend to have cramps or pain. So that we need to explain. Suppose a person is having a cramp or pain, then we change it over to lactitol instead of the lactulose. So, but all the randomized control trials have been done on lactulose rather than on the lactitol. So we are going to go up to the maximum tolerable dose of the lactulose, which can be 20 ml TID as well. So like majority of the people tend to do well. If at all they are not able to tolerate or a person is still in encephalopathy, we can give enema preparations as well. So we can give through the rectum. Thereby the persons will generally resolve the encephalopathy. On top of it, we are giving nowadays, rather than keep on increasing the dose of lactulose, so we tend to add on rifaximin, which is a gut-specific antibiotic at a dose of 550 milligram twice in a day, such that the bacteria within the small bowel are going to come down, thereby the chance of encephalopathy episodes can come down. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. There's a second question from Dr. Shinoy, sir. Sir is asking, what is the role of albumin infusion in alcoholic hepatitis?
Yeah, thank you, sir. Very important question. So we tend to keep albumin like predominantly in people who tend to have a lower serum albumin. Like especially when the serum albumin is less than 2.5, they tend to be more edematous. On top of it, they can have a concomitant hepatorrhea syndrome or a kidney injury, acute kidney injury. So then we need to increase the intravascular volume. So we tend to give albumin, that is 20%, like we give over 4 to 6 hours time. So the ideal recommended dose is 1 gram per kg body weight. But in Indian patients, they don't tolerate because they tend to have a concomitant cardiac illness as well. So we tend to give 20% albumin once in a day for 4 to 6 hours. Predominantly, we choose patients who tend to have a higher creat or people who tend to have an albumin, which is serum albumin, which is less than 2.5 milligram per deciliter. But albumin half-life is 28 days. It is not going to change dramatically. So we tend to continue the albumin till the creatinine improves. Because once you increase the intravascular volume, then the kidneys will start feeling better and the creatinine will start decreasing. So we continue albumin once in a day or twice in a day, look at the cardiac function and then look at the creatinine, like how long to give albumin, because albumin is a costly molecule. So we tend to give very slowly. So because it is a protein, a lot of allergic reactions can happen. So the treatment is predominantly for the kidney rather than for the liver. So, because once the liver starts improving, then the albumin automatically will start improving. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
It doesn't have a role in alcoholic hepatitis, but in a decompensated liver disease, predominantly with AKA or hepatorrhea syndrome, we tend to give albumin.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, doctor, sir, any questions, you can please unmute yourself or you can use the chat box. Sir, one more thing, sir. Like, there is a large, there's a lot of talking about probiotics as well, sir. So any role of probiotics in this set of alcoholic liver disease or any other liver disease, sir?
Yeah, so nowadays the gut bacteria has been involved for everything from obesity to Alzheimer's disease. So the most important thing is like it is still evolving. The WHO guidelines so far, the probiotics have got no much role in the liver improvement. So the most important thing is like the caution is in a decompensated liver disease, when we give probiotics, there can be a chance of bacteremia. So because majority of the time, it is because of the bacterial translocation that happens. That's why we have a preference on rifaximin rather than a probiotic. So rifaximin reduces the bacterial flora within the small intestine, which are generally the ammonia generators. So we are got a propensity to give rifaximin as a gut-specific antibiotic rather than a probiotic in a alcoholic liver or a non-liver. But before they develop the liver disease, whether it is going to help or not, that is a debatable issue, like which probiotic, what dose, how long to give, whether that is going to metabolize alcohol or not. So those are all still, the data is yet to come. I think currently it doesn't have much role as far as in alcoholic hepatitis or alcoholic liver disease.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. And one more thing, sir. You spoke about UDC as well. You spoke about SAMe as well. But any thing about vitamin E, sir? Any role of vitamin E in these set of patients?
So I didn't touch upon, I didn't go into the depth of NAFLD. So the thing is, like, predominantly in a diabetic with fatty liver, so we tend to give vitamin E. So like 400 micrograms.
Yes, sir. International units, sir.
Yeah, 400 international units. So the thing is, like, predominantly, like, lot of Indians don't tolerate twice in a day dose. So we tend to give 400 once in a day. And the main problem with vitamin E is it got predisposition for development of prostate breast problems. So we need to caution that. And predominantly, it is given like an antioxidant. So, in NAFLD, it definitely has got a role. The second molecule is pioglitazone. So because it has got both effect on the triglyceride reduction within the liver as well as on the diabetes. So these are all the two molecules preferentially noted in diabetic and fatty liver. And the third molecule will be saroglitazone. So which comes at 4 mg once in a day dose. Predominantly we look at the fasting lipid profile. If at all there is a fatty liver plus triglyceride level, then saroglitazone will work. Fatty liver plus diabetic, the option will be UDCA plus minus pioglitazone or UDCA plus minus vitamin E or a vitamin E plus minus pioglitazone depending upon the existing medication. Because treatment has to be individualized, we need to see like what are all the parameters where the particular person is fitting in. Predominantly, if at all the bilirubin elevation is there, predominantly if at all alkaline phosphatase and GGT elevation is there, UDCA will help. Because it has got both on the hepatocyte level as well as the cholangiocyte level. If at all in the LFT panel, SGOT, SGPT are high, then acetonosin methionine has got little better hand on those people. So because the necroinflammatory action is much better in that, because it is going to reduce the oxidation potential by giving the methionine. But again, it has got a sulfur moiety, acetonosin methionine. So if a person is little sulfur allergic or something like that, so we need to look at and balance it out. It's not like it cannot be done. So we don't know like what molecule can help a person. It's only during follow-up we tend to see whether an additional hepatoprotective, like suppose a person is on UDCA, should we add on acetonisin methionine? Or should we add on N-acetylcysteine if a person is coagulopathic? These are all the things that we need to look for. Because all the metabolisms are interrelated, like N-acetylcysteine is nothing but, which is again a cysteine, which is one step lesser than the methionine. So, you know, if at all the metabolism is intact, so like it should be all right. Coagulopathy, definitely N-acetylcysteine. Non-coagulopathy, anictric hepatitis, acetonisin methionine. Ictric hepatitis predominantly in the form of alphas, GGT elevation, UDCA. So majority of the time, this is a rule. During follow-up, we see the trend and then based on that, we decide after excluding relevant investigations.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, one last thing, sir, like you talked extensively about this malnutrition as well. Even the poor people are having. So how do you manage this malnutrition, sir? Any specific nutrients which are, because that will be add-on therapy for the patients and affordability might be also coming into issue.
Yeah, so ideally nutritional assessment itself is a big topic. So like I generally look at the albumin, I generally look at the muscle mass. Majority of these people will not be having the urge to eat. Like always I tell the family member to walk along with the patient. So because whenever they are walking, they are doing the exercise together. So whenever they are burning the calories, automatically they will feel hungry. Otherwise the feeling in the mind that they are sick. So we'll limit their day-to-day activities. Once they are not doing any physical exercise, then the calorie or the amount of calorie that they are going to take will be much lesser. I have got a predilection for giving Ensure peptide because rather than giving a protein molecule, The peptide's absorption is much faster, as well as the assimilation to the muscle is much better. So as far as the other micronutrients are considered, it becomes it depends upon, we assess the person, like whether a person has got night blindness or muscle cramp, whether skin changes are there or not. So it depends on that. Based on that, we do a check. Because like if at all you give a fat-soluble vitamins, there can be a chance of toxicity, because there is no problem in giving B-complex, because it is water-soluble and it comes out in the urine. So that's why whenever we take B-complex, the urine will be yellow in color. But fat-soluble vitamins, whenever we supplement, there is a higher chance that there will be hypervitaminosis. So we are going to assess, and then depending upon that, we are going to supplement. It should be individualized.
Yes. Yes, yes, sir. Thank you, sir. I'll just check the chat box, sir, if there are further questions. I think, sir, we do not have any further questions, sir. Again, sir, thank you very much for sparing your valuable time and enlightening us this in one of the very important topic. And thank you very much for that wonderful question and answer session as well. And thank you very much for all the doctors for your kind participation. And again, I must thank my sales colleague, sir, Amlan and Madhu and his team for bringing you as a speaker for today's evening session.
Thank you. We will have
physical CME, sir. Otherwise, we'll continue to have webinars. Please enlighten us with further sessions on various other topics as well, sir.
Thank you, Ragaji, and thank you one and all. Have a nice weekend.
Thank you. You too, sir. Please take care, sir. Thank you.